300 meters and we touched bottom. At this deep, ordeals showed that the pressure was more than 30 times that at the surface, an alarming 450 pounds per square inch. The lights from our submarine revealed countless particles slowly descending all around us and settling on the seabed. The marine biologist Rachel Carson poetically described this phenomenon in her 1951 book, The Sea Around Us, writing, "When I think of the floor of the deep sea, I see always the steady unremaining downward drift of materials from above, flake upon flake, layer up layer, the most stupendous snowfall there has ever seen." This is a paragraph of the last book of David Attenborough, Ocean, the Earth's Last Wildness. In collaboration with Colin Backfly, they write this book. And here we're going to talk about one phenomena that we mentioned in other videos, the marine snow, and the relation that it has with a comment that we had in another video, the CCD. Welcome to Ocean Science. Today I will explain you what the marine snow is and how it's related with the carbon compensation depth. So, what is the marine snow? Maybe you have seen on the deep ocean videos. This is a continuous shower of organic materials falling from the upper layers to the deep layers of the ocean. This phenomenon is essential to recycle nutrients and to sequester carbon, composed by phytoplankton, fecal pellets, mucus, and inorganic material. And this is a key point, so we have the inorganic part and the organic part. So we will have in the organic part aggregates of dead organisms, and in the inorganic part we will have the shells, so the calcium shells and also the silical shells. For making the aggregation of these different materials, we have the marine gel, and this is composed of exopolymeric materials that helps in the sinking dynamics. These dynamics are affected by the size of the particle, the composition, and the density, and of course are affected by the turbulence and the ocean current. So when these particles fall down, they have decomposition by the zooplankton, bacteria, and this is part of the biological carbon pump. For not extending more this video, we can remain with the idea that the biological carbon pump means that some organisms can take the carbon dioxide from the atmosphere or also from the upper layers of the ocean and transform by photosynthesis in organic matter. But this is the simplest way that we can explain the biological carbon pump. It's an extended topic, so we can remain with this idea to continue with marine snow. And of course, when this organic and inorganic material goes down into the layers of the ocean, it's gonna bring some nutrient to the deepest part of the ocean. And this is essential for the microbial communities that are in the deep layers of the ocean. And these particles bring the carbon from the surface to the deep part of the ocean. So that helps to sequester carbon from the atmosphere and put it there for hundreds or thousands of years. So this is a way to store carbon, and of course helps with the climate change, because the carbon that we have now in the atmosphere changed to form part of the deepest layers of the ocean, remaining there until the next millennium. And reducing the levels of CO2 that we have in the atmosphere, of course, helps to this climate change, but also to the ocean acidification, as it not form parts of the ocean, so it doesn't change the chemistry of the ocean, but it remain storage in one place, so in at these particles. But as I said in the beginning of the video, and of course in the title, we have another topic that I even touched yet, the CCD, the carbon compensation depth. And what is this CCD? This is the depth where the calcium carbonate the liver is equal to the one who is dissolved. So it's the line that the particles have to see where they start to lose more calcium carbonate than the ones who they have. That means that this particle is not going to arrive to the bottom of the ocean. And here we don't gonna have, for example, rocks made of calcium carbonate. So at how many meters we have this line? We are talking about 4,000 and 5,000 meters. And this of course can change on the temperature, depth, pH, and of course CO2 levels of that point. And this is possible because of dissolvation. This is the process when a solid dissolves into a liquid. For the calcium carbonate, the reaction on the seawater looks something like this. And in the deep cold waters, when the CO2 concentrations are higher, the carbonate becomes unstable and becomes more solid. So at great depths, we will have this solvation that is greater than the sedimentation of the calcium carbonate. But of course, we don't have only one line. We have also the Lissuk line. This is the line before of the CCD that starts to show something related with it. So when this solvation starts to work harder, so we will have the same levels of sedimentation or solvation until we arrive to the CCD, when this change and the solvation became greater than the sedimentation and we lose all this material. But as we know from geology or chemistry, we have calcite and aragonite. So the two types of calcium carbonate. And of course, as we have two types, we will have two lines, the ACD, so the aragonite compensation depth, and the CCD, the calcium compensation depth, or in this case, the calcite compensation depth. As we have the aragonite less stable than the calcite, we will have the ACD shallower than the CCD. So the organisms that build aragonite shells are more vulnerable to the ocean acidification as different corals that we can have. So what happened after this dissolution? The thing is that this became two ions that remains in the deep waters. But the carbonate can also react with the hydrogen in more acid waters. This will reduce the ocean alkalinity and became harder to store the carbon. And with the thermal incirculation, these materials will come back to the surface, taking 100 to 1000 of years. And when this happens, some CO2 can be back to the surface. So not all this carbon will remain in the ocean. And this is important to know because now I'm gonna touch a controversial topic, the ocean fertilization. This is the concept that says that if we put the right nutrients in the right place with sunlight, some algae, and the right circulation conditions, we can fertilize the ocean. So that means that these algae are gonna take all the nutrients, gonna make photosynthesis and get all the carbon that we have in the atmosphere. So in this layer of the ocean, in the surface layer, and then through the sinking of these particles, as the marine snow or helping by the ocean circulation, we will store all this carbon from the atmosphere, taking only one place of the ocean to fertilize, and everything will be perfect. And this seems perfect because we are not seeing the whole ocean. So as I was talking all this time, we have different lines of depth where the carbon is not gonna sink anymore there. So if it's making by one part of carbonate calcium or aragonate calcium, you have these different lines at 4,000 meters, 5,000 meters. So we will never have this sinking of the carbon. But maybe it's not the case. Maybe we can talk about 3,000 meters and saying that, okay, we fertilize the ocean and we will have the sinking of the particles, and they will remain there for a thousand of years or many thousand of years. Okay, perfect. But we have a lot of things there. We have this biological pump that changed everything, how we see this ocean sinking. And of course, we have the ocean dynamics. So it depends where we are gonna make this, gonna change. And of course, the different projects that are now trying to work or already made something, they didn't analyze everything. And the current is something that we need to continue with the study of it, so you cannot predict where these particles will be in 100 years. So it's not that simple. The only thing that we obtain of this is changing the environment, as always. So depending where we want to make this, for example, in the coast of California, or for example, in the Antarctica, as they are thinking to, is not the best option, because when they talk about ocean fertilization, they talk about put some particular nutrients. And these nutrients, we have another issue with that, because they change the composition when they're in the sea. We have, for example, iron. But not all the iron that we can put in the ocean will be assimilated by the different algae and organisms that they think, because this switch, depending on the temperatures, on the light, also the light affects how the particles work. So the thing that I want to say is that not always is that easy as it seems. So we need to be completely clear of what we're gonna do, why we're gonna do this, and how we're gonna attain these results, because we don't have the magic way of sinking carbon and forget about it, of this climate that we're changing, so we sink everything in the ocean, that's enough. It's not the way. So we need to see the different options that we have and then start to make one by one and seeing the different results, because anyone has the magic wand. So that is all for today. This was a difficult video to make because I mix a lot of complex concepts, but I hope that you remain with the idea that it's not always simple as it seems. And also, I'm not good at chemistry, so sorry if there is some data that is not completely accurate, but I hope that you remain with the idea. I was inspired by this book and all the papers that I left in the description. And thank you for watching, and I will see you in the next video. Bye bye.